गुड मॉर्निंग फ्रेंड्स. इन टुडे लेक्चर वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट सब ग्रुप्स. सो इन लास्ट टू लेक्चर्स वी सी व्हाट इज अ ग्रुप, व्हाट आर द बेसिक रिजल्ट्स ऑफ अ ग्रुप. वी टुक सर्टेन एग्जांपल्स टू अंडरस्टैंड द कंसेप्ट ऑफ ग्रुप्स. सो लेट्स स्टार्ट अवर टुडेज टॉपिक, दैट इज सब ग्रुप. सो व्हाट इज अ सब ग्रुप? सो लेट्स टेक वी हैव अ ग्रुप जी स्टार. लेट्स सपोज वी हैव अ ग्रुप जी स्टार. And H is any subset of G. Let's suppose H is any subset of G. Now let us consider this is G. G is a group with binary operation star. Now what we are doing, we are taking a subset of G, that is H. So we are saying that this H, which is subset of G, it is subgroup of G if H itself is a group under the binary operation of G. In simple words, if I say G star is a group and H is a subset of G, H will be the subgroup if H comma star is a group. And H comma star is a group, it means star is closed under binary operation, star is associative, existence of identity and existence of the inverse of the every element of H. So it means if we take any two element A and B in H, then A star B should be in H. Moreover, there should be the identity element E. The inverse of A, that is A inverse, should be in H. The inverse of B, that is B inverse, should be in H. The only thing that is associative, that is trivial, because H is a subset of G and G is a group, it means G is associative in nature, it means H must be a associative in nature with respect to the binary operation star. So it means H subset of G is a subgroup of G if H comma star is a group. Here star is a binary operation of the group G star. So every group has two trivial subgroups. That two trivial subgroups are the G itself, and if we take the single element identity of G, and all other subgroups of G are called non-trivial subgroups of G. Now let us take few examples to understand the concept of subgroups. So now let us take this particular example, a quite interesting one. So we are taking a group, that is Z plus. We know that the set of integer with usual addition forms a group. And now we are taking H1 as a set of all even integers. So it's very clear that H1 is a subset of Z. And moreover, what is this H1? This H1 is set all even integers. All even integer means minus 6, minus 4, minus 2, 0, 2, 4, 6, and so on. Or moreover, we can say that H1 is equal to twice of Z. Now, we are claiming that this H1 is the subgroup of Z. What does it mean? We want to prove that this H1 with usual addition is a subgroup. So we know that if we take any two even numbers, their sum will be again an even number. Reason, if we take any two elements, say A and B belongs to this H1, what will happen? This A should be of form 2m and B should be of form 2n for some m comma n belongs to Z, because they are even number, there will be multiple of 2s. And what will be A plus B? A plus B will be twice of m plus n, means again even number. So first thing we have cleared that this plus is closed under H1. If we take any two elements of AB and apply the binary operation plus, then the resultant is again an even integer. Second thing, associative. Since the set of integers are associative with respect to the usual addition, it means H1 must be associative with respect to plus. Moreover, if we talk about identity element, we know if we add 0 to any element, we will get the same element again. We know that 2m plus 0 is equal to 2m is equal to 0 plus 2m. So this 0 will be the identity of this H1. And if we talk about inverse, then again, minus 2m is the inverse of 2m, because 2m plus minus 2m is equal to 0 is equal to minus 2m plus 2m. So clearly this H1 plus is a group with respect to the usual addition. It means this H1 is a subgroup of G. Now let us take the another set H2. Now what is this H2? Now at the place of the even integers, now we are taking the odd integers only. Now let us take the odd integers. So one thing is clear again, this H2 will be the subset of the set of integers, because these are just odd integers. So what will be the H2? H2 will be the all odd numbers. Odd numbers are the numbers which are not the multiple of 2. Or it will be a form of 2m plus 1 or 2m plus minus 1. So need not to write in the form of the sets. Or if you want to write it, you can write it as 2m plus minus 1. And this m is basically belong to the set of natural numbers. Then it will become set of integers. For 0, what we have to do, m will be 0, then it will be 1, minus 1, then it will be 2, 3, plus minus 1. So for 0, what we have to do, we have to take 0 included, union 0. We have to take 0 in this case. So this is your H2. Now what is the problem? Now let us take two odd integers. The two odd integers are clearly one belongs to H2 and 3 is also odd number. 3 belongs to H2. So what does it mean? It means if we take 1 plus 3, that is equal to 4, and we know that 4 is even number, so it does not belong to H2. So it means this plus, binary operation plus, is not closed under H2. It means H2 comma plus cannot be a group. It means H2 is not a subgroup of the set of integers with usual operation as usual addition. So if we take the set of even integers, it becomes a subgroup. But if we take the set of all odd integers, it is not a subgroup. Now let us take another example to understand the concept of subgroups. Now let us take a set F. The set of all functions defined on set A. And the binary operation plus here. So it means what type of this operator is? F plus g of x is equal to f of x plus gx. One can easily prove that this becomes a group, because this is basically a usual addition. It will be associative. F and g are the two functions from a to a, therefore f plus g is also a function from a to a, closed also. If we take the null function, a function 0 from the set A to set A, such that 0 of x is equal to 0 for all x belongs to A, then this function will become an identity element with respect to the addition, and the minus f will be inverse of f. So clearly this f plus will become a group. Now let us take a subset, C subset of M. Now what is this C? C again the set of all functions defined in the set A, that is, now here F is again from A to A, but the condition is F is continuous function. Continuous. So if it is continuous function, what does it imply? We know that the sum of two continuous functions is again a continuous function. So the closure can be proved easily. Associative by default, then identity element, this zero function will become the identity element, and minus f will become the inverse of f, because if f is a continuous function, then minus f is also a continuous function. So what does it mean? It means c comma plus will become a subgroup of the f plus. Now in all these examples, you may notice that to prove that particular subset is a subgroup or not, we have to check the four properties, at least three properties if we ignore the associative one. So it means we require some result by which we can easily say that whether a particular subset of a group is a subgroup or not. Now let us take that subgroup test. Now it is small theorem, important one. It says let G be a group and H is a subset of G. Now what it says, H is a subgroup of G if and only if AB inverse, if and only if AB inverse belongs to H for all A comma B belongs to H. So now it is very strong result. What does this result give? It means to check whether a particular subset is a subgroup or not, it is just sufficient to check this. If this relation holds, then it means that particular subset becomes a subgroup. So now let us try to first prove it. Now proof is quite simple. Now first let's consider that H is a subgroup. First we consider that H is a subgroup of G. Now what we need to prove that? We have to prove that. What is required to prove that? Now required to prove that for any A comma B belongs to H, AB inverse belongs to H. We have to prove this. Now let us take A comma B belongs to H. Now H is a subgroup. So here H is a subgroup, and subgroup means H is a group. Under the binary operation of G. So it means since A and B belong to H and H is a group, it means the inverse of every element exists. What does it imply? The inverse of B, that is B inverse, should belong to H. Again, H is a group, it means it binary operation should be closed under H. What does it imply? Now, here A is one element, B inverse is another element. So, what does it imply? Closure means AB inverse should belong to H. So, the first thing we have proved that if H is a subgroup of G, then for all A and B belongs to H, this AB inverse belongs to H. Now, let us take the inverse part, that is important also. Now, what is given? Now it is given that AB inverse belongs to H for all A comma B belongs to H. Now what is required to prove? we have to prove that H is a group under the binary operation of G. This we have to prove that. And to prove that it is a group, we have to prove the three things. One, closure property, existence of identity, existence of the inverse of every element of H. Associative comes from the G. Since G is a group, it is associative, and H is a subset of G, it means H must be associative. So, first of all, we try to find the identity element. Now, we have just one thing. The thing is that AB inverse belongs to H for all A, B belongs to G. Now, let us see how we can find the identity element. Now, let us take A belongs to H. We are considering that this H is non-empty. Because if H is empty, then it is by definition that empty set is, H is not empty, so let us take A belongs to H. If it is empty, it means by default it is a group, subgroup of G. So let us take A belongs to H. Now what that it means, we have given that for all A, B belongs to H, AB inverse belongs to H. So what that it implies, if we take B also equal to A, B also equal to A, in this particular relation, what does it mean? A inverse belongs to H. And we also know that H is a subset of G. It is an important thing. And G is a group. It is given that G is a group. So A into A inverse should be equal to identity by the definition of identity element. So it means E must belongs to H. And one thing we have more proof that the identity element of a group and subgroup are same. They have the same identity element. So we prove that E is the identity element of H, and this E is basically identity element of G. So we have proved that the identity element of H and G are same, or we can say that H has an identity element. Now let us talk about the inverse of the elements. So again, let A belongs to H. Okay. We have just proved that E also belongs to H. H has an identity element, same as the identity element of the group G. Now, in this particular relation, what we are doing, we are taking A is equal to E and B is equal to B. So what we have done, we have taken A is equal to E and B is equal to A. We have considered that A belongs to H, and we know that identity elements belongs to H. So by this relation, what does it mean? It means that E A inverse, which is equal to A inverse, belongs to H. So what does it mean? It means if A belongs to H, then its inverse element A inverse also belongs to H. And we know that A dot A inverse is equal to E is equal to A inverse A. So we have proven that for any A belongs to H, its inverse exists, that is A inverse, and that A inverse also belongs to H. Now we have proven that two things. Number one, existence of the identity, existence of the inverse of every element. Now let's talk about the closure property. For the closure property, what we have to take? We have to take the two elements. Now, let A, B belongs to H. Now, what do we have to prove that? We have to prove that What is required to prove? The required to prove is AB belongs to H. Required to prove that AB belongs to H. So now how we will do? Now we have proved that in H every element has an inverse element. So since B belongs to H, so what does it imply? B inverse also belongs to H, because we have just proved that every element in H has an inverse element which belongs to H. So B inverse belongs to H. Now, in this particular identity, now let us take again A is equal to A and B is equal to B inverse. Or if you are confused with same numbers, so for your comfort, I can take it H and K. Now let us suppose H and K belongs to H. And we have to require to prove that H into K belongs to H. Since K belongs to H, it means the inverse should also belong to it. So we can say that K inverse belongs to H. Now, what we will do? We will take A is equal to H and B is equal to K inverse. So make the thing simple. So what this relation says? It means that AB inverse, which becomes H, K inverse inverse, and K inverse K inverse is equal to K, we know that H into K belongs to H, because AB inverse belongs to H, and AB inverse is H of K inverse K inverse, K inverse K inverse is K, so it means H into K belongs to H. So what we prove? That we prove existence of identity, existence of inverse of each element of H, and also the closure property. So it means that this H is a group, and therefore the by definition of subgroups, this H will become a subgroup of G. So what is the use of this particular result? Now let us take the same example again. Like first example we have taken. So we know that this is a group. Now we are talking about 2z. 2z means set of all even integers. Now we want to prove that this 2z is a subgroup of z. How we can do? Just simple. We take any two element. Now let us take A and B belongs to 2z. So we know that A is equal to 2m and B is equal to 2m. Now here the operation is plus. Here we are considering the operation as multiplication. So here AB inverse, this AB inverse will become A minus B belongs to H. Here it is with respect to multiplication, and with respect to the addition operator, it will become A minus B belongs to H. So to prove that this 2z is a subgroup of z, what we have to prove? That we have to prove that A minus B belongs to H. And what is the A minus B? A minus B is 2 of M minus N, and this M minus N can be written as P, and again this P is integer, or if we are taking this m and n, yes, take integer. So this 2p belongs to 2z. So what we can say? That by this particular theorem, we can say that this 2z is a subgroup of z. So initially what we have done, we prove that the identity, inverse, and then closure property. Now, just using this theorem, in one step, we can prove that the 2z is a subgroup of z. Now, let's move to the another result. Another result, important one is, let H and K are two subgroups of G. Now let H and K are two subgroups of G. Now what we want to prove? That prove that H intersection K is a subgroup. So again, one line proof. What will you prove? What you want to prove that H inter K section K is a subgroup of G. So using last theorem, let A comma B belongs to H intersection K. So what is required to prove? We just require to prove that AP inverse belongs to H intersection K. To prove that it is subgroup of G, we have to just prove that AB inverse or any A comma B belongs to H intersection K, AB inverse should belongs to H intersection K. Now, AB belongs to H intersection K, what does it imply? This implies A comma B belongs to H and A comma B belongs to K. Now, H and K are the two subgroups of G. So, again using the last theorem, what does it imply? AB inverse belongs to H and AB inverse also belongs to K. So, from here what we can say that AB inverse belongs to H intersection K. So, we have proof that for any A comma B belongs to H intersection K, AB inverse belongs to H intersection K. It means H intersection K is the subgroup of G. Now the last and important observation. What about H union K? What about H union K? Whether they are H union K is a subgroup or not. So now let us take an example. Again we are taking Z plus is a group. Now let us take H is equal to 2Z. We have just proved that 2Z is a subgroup of Z with respect to the usual addition. And K is equal to 3Z. And on the same lines, we can also prove that 3Z is also a subgroup of Z plus. So, now let us talk about H union K. Okay. Now, what will be H union K? H union K will be 2Z union 3Z. And now let us take two elements. We know that 2 belongs to 2z, 3 belongs to 3z. So 2 comma 3 belongs to H union K. 2 from H and 3 from K. So 2 comma 3 belongs to H union K. Now what is 2 minus 3? This is equal to minus 1. But we know that minus 1 does not belong to 2z. Minus 1 also does not belong to 3z. 2z means the multiple of 2. 3z means the multiple of all 3. So minus 1 does not belong to H and K. So minus 1 does not belong to H union K. So what is our conclusion? Our conclusion is that if H and K are the two subgroups of J, H union K may or may not be a subgroup of G. In some cases it may be a subgroup, but in other cases it is not a subgroup. So the next question arises, under what condition this H union K will become a subgroup of G? Under what condition this H union K is the subgroup of G? The only case is when either H is a subset of K or K is a subset of H. Then only the H union K will become a subgroup. So the next topic we will discuss, that is cyclic subgroups. So for today it's all. Now let us move. In the next lecture we will talk about the cyclic subgroups. Thank you.